Good afternoon. Have a seat, please. I'm Dr. Bob Philpott. I'm the professor and chairman of the Department of PA Studies, and it's my pleasure to preside over today's UTMB Physician Assistant White Coat Ceremony. The ceremony has become a milestone and tradition for the UTMB PA program since 2001. It recognizes the transition of new students into the PA program, into the profession, and into their career as a physician assistant. Please stand. Never mind, you've already stood. Our PA teaching faculty present today are Dr. Robert Beach, Assistant Professor Holly Good, Director of Clinical Education, Associate Professor Dr. Ashley Guillory, she's our Director of Admissions, Assistant Professor Dora Hawkinson, she's our Chair of the Program Progress and Promotions Committee, Assistant Professor Carla Hirsch, Assistant Professor Angela Jones, Assistant Professor and Director of PA Program Assessment, Dr. Julie Kutak. Assistant Professor and Director of Didactic Education, Veronica Marciano. Assistant Professor and Vice Chair for Diversity, Inclusion, and Community Engagement, Professor Fadeke Okeolola. Assistant Professor and Director of Clinical Education, Darcy Ortiz. Assistant Professor Paul Shreve. Associate Program Director and Assistant Professor, Dr. Michael Whitehead. We're also honored to have the following special guests. Dr. Ben G. Raymer, UTMB President. Dr. Charles Mouton, UTMB Executive Vice President, Provost, and Dean of the John Seeley School of Medicine. Dr. Janet Sutherland, Vice President, Interprofessional Education, Institutional Effectiveness, and Health Education Center. Dr. Micah Woods, Dean for Academic Affairs, John Seeley School of Medicine. Dr. Jeffrey Sussman, Senior Associate Dean for Educational Performance, John Seeley School of Medicine. Dr. Pierre Banks, Senior Director of Admissions and Recruitment, School of Medicine. Dr. Holly West, Senior Medical Educator, Educational Development, and Adjunct Associate Professor, Physician Assistant Studies. And Reagan Davis, Physician Assistant Manager, Department of Otolaryngology, Adjunct Instructor, Physician Assistant Studies. Now I'd like to welcome Dr. Raymer to give us some opening remarks.
Thank you, Dr. Philpott, and class, thank you for keeping your commitment and showing up to start your education and to finish your education. I want to thank all the people who are here today who are joining us. I know that many of you are parents, so let's get this out of the way immediately. All parents of students, would you please stand? Thank you for joining us today, and thank you for being an important part of your loved one's educational process. If they're busy and are not returning your phone calls as often as you think they should, call Dr. Philpott. He's always available for you to talk to about things like that. But believe it or not, they have some hard days ahead, and they will be studying, usually in this building or one of the surrounding buildings. They will be putting a lot of effort into this course of study that they have chosen. They need your support, so fresh cookies and things like that are more than welcome. I want to speak to you from my viewpoint. My viewpoint goes back to 1969 when I came to UTMB as a graduate student. And then later on as a medical student, and then later on as a resident in the area of pediatrics. So I've been here quite a while. I've been able to observe this institution. I was even around when Bob Beach was a little boy, you know, and that's a long time ago. First of all, let me tell you, I wasn't here in 1891 when this place was started, but there are some people who I've heard rumors are and still are here. I want to just tell you how glad we are that you are here, that you have chosen to do this education phase of your life at UTMB. I want you to know that there are people here that are going to do everything in their power to be sure that you get the absolute best education that a physician assistant will ever get anywhere in the United States, or maybe even the whole world. It's always inspiring to attend these ceremonies that mark rites of passages for our students. The next one that you've got marked on your calendar is probably your graduation. Today, though, you're going to kick that off in great form by donning the white coat of the healthcare professional. That will be emblematic of who you are and what you do for the next many years of your life. Today marks that new chapter in your life as a healer, a chapter as real as it can ever be. Your patients will trust you with information that they've never told anyone else. They will trust your confidence and trust your ability to keep their secrets. They will trust your judgment and your ability to arrive at the correct diagnosis and treatment pathway. You will become a part of an incredible team, including doctors and nurses and physical therapists and occupational therapists and nutritionists and countless other healthcare professionals that bring to your patient the very best of modern healthcare. Our faculty are looking forward, if not perhaps a little apprehensive, in training you, mentoring you, and indeed getting to know you. You will find that they are not surrogate parents. They're not here to make your decisions for you, but they're here to help you grow and learn that decision-making responsibility. As UTMB students, you are now part of a powerful legacy of service. Many of you will, and perhaps already have found areas of service in our homeless clinics, in the St. Vincent's House program, and those kinds of service here on the island. If you haven't discovered them, I hope you will investigate immediately or see Dr. Mouton and I after the program adjourns today. You've worked hard to get to this point, so don't check out and take a vacation. You know, every now and then I meet a student who the whole goal was getting into school. The goal is getting out of school. Okay, so reset your plans right now. Your goal is to complete the best job that you can do. As physician's assistants, you will all play a critical role in the healthcare team, helping to improve access to excellent healthcare, helping to make your communities healthier and advance the field of science in general. We feel fortunate to count you among UTMB's own. You will leave here as a physician assistant and as an alum of this incredible institution. 130 years of excellence in healthcare, the oldest and first health professional school in Texas. We feel fortunate to count you as our own. We hope you will be counting your blessings of being here and being a part of one of the best student bodies in the world. And we know your future patients will be fortunate to have you by their side. Welcome to the best days of your life. Thank you.
it's now my pleasure to invite Dr. Mouton to come to the podium and address the class of 2023.
Thank you, Dr. Philpott. It's an honor to welcome you all here this afternoon. I share President Raymond's welcome to all our family, friends, loved ones who are here to support our wonderful physician assistant students. I'm glad that many of you all have come here for this momentous occasion. As future health professionals training and advancing in their careers, they will lean on you for encouragement. And as Dr. Raymond mentioned, as many chocolate chip or oatmeal cookies as you can bake to make sure you can provide them good sustenance. You will play an important part in their career. So when they complain about being tired or being overworked or studying hard, remind them that they begged us to let them into the institution to get this training. So you can help us with that. To our students, I obviously extend my sincere congratulations to you having made it thus far and for following up on a commitment you made when you applied to come here. As a physician assistant, your career obviously will be distinguished by the tremendous amount of trust that President Raymer has already told you about and the responsibility that patients place in your hands. You are now at the point where you have done what Sir William Osler talked about. That's you have now started to develop the skills where you understand healthcare. That is, you have the chart for the seas of health. But now it's time for what he described as sailing those seas. So if you don't go into clinical training with that same mindset and diligence, while you may understand the map of the human body or health, you won't be able to sail the seas of providing care. Because it's the clinical skills that you develop that's going to be so important to this. You're going to have to rely on your compassion, your dedication, your knowledge. Patients are going to expect from you. I say this to you, you probably don't remember this, but I said it to you when you came in. I say it to my MD program students when they come in. You are now entering a profession. And what that means is society expects you to hold yourself in a certain way. We are a self-regulating, self-governing body. And so because of that, we expect the highest level of professionalism. You represent UTMB. When you go out to your road, we expect you to deliver what you know to be right, but to act in a professional manner at all times. I keep saying and emphasizing that because it's so important. The public trusts you with this, and so you have to keep that in front of you. Your skills, your dedication is something that we obviously need greatly in this country. I think the COVID pandemic has taught us we can't have enough quality healthcare workers. And so you have to come and help join in that fight to provide healthcare to the communities that we so desperately care for and need your help. Just as importantly, your training that you receive here at UTMB will lend itself to you becoming innovative, ready to care for all the patients you provide health to and provide solutions to their health challenges. You will do this through your patient care, research, education, and come back to the faculty as leaders. Remember, Dr. Philpott wants you. He needs you to help train that next generation. As you receive your white coat, you become part of a long line of healthcare providers that have dedicated themselves to service and care of patients. This white coat symbolizes the meaningful role that you will play in their lives and your commitment to doing your best to serve with honor, perseverance, duty, and compassion. When you take your pen, that would mean that you are dedicating yourselves to the role as a physician assistant in the care of the patient and making sure that the team of people that care for them give them their best care possible. We clearly are proud of you, everyone in this auditorium. They stood up when you walked in. That's a sign of our pride. So we're proud of you and the educational success you've shown so far, and we look forward to what you're going to achieve as you continue to move forward. So first off, congratulations to each of you. You've got past the foundational time. Now it's time to do the hard work and get past those clinical skills that you're all going to develop. So again, congratulations, and I'll turn the program back over to Dr. Philpott.
Time goes by so fast. And, you know, in 15 short months, we're going to be happy to call you alumni. I'd like to introduce Gordon Lee. He's the president of the UTMB PA Alumni Association. He's a physician assistant at Limestone Medical Center in Grossbach, Texas, and a 1985 graduate of the UTMB PA program. Please welcome Gordon Lee.
Dr. Reamer in pediatrics at the time. So we've both been around a while. Okay. I am the president of the Physician Assistant Alumni Association and its board of directors. And I am currently practicing in a rural health clinic in Grossbeck, Texas. I am truly honored to be here today to celebrate this momentous occasion with you. Many years ago, our classes were much smaller. It's amazing to see how much this association of PAs has grown in this time frame. I face these same days like you coming ahead with a little bit of anxiety. Would I actually measure up? Could I actually do the job? My journey has provided me with a great personal sense of achievement, but not so much for myself, but for the care that I've delivered over the years to the patients who came seeking, looking for care that we develop here at UTMB Galveston. This ceremony literally marks the beginning of your career as a healthcare professional and affirms the bond that the UTMB alumni feel for our program. What you've accepting, where you're going, is a lifetime commitment, not just to the PA profession, but also to education of yourself and your patients. That affirms the oath that we took years ago and that you will take also, and hopefully will continue to fulfill throughout your entire career. So on behalf of the Physician Assistant Studies Alumni Association, I welcome you to UTMB and wish you the very best while you're here. And I truly look forward to welcoming you to this profession, and in just a few years, to our distinguished Alumni Association. Again, congratulations on this, the first of hopefully many milestones in your career.
Our next speaker, she told me that this is probably the smallest crowd she's ever spoken to. But I think that we can welcome her with a big round of applause and make it feel like a much bigger crowd. I'd like to welcome the class president of the 50th class, Ashley Simon.
Good afternoon, everybody. Like Dr. Philpott said, my name's Ashley Simon, and I am the president of the class of 2023, and it's been one of the biggest honors of my life. Many of you will probably relate to how I was feeling this time last June, just really anxious to start PA school. Quite literally every PA student I had talked to up until that point had told me the cliche, it's like you're drinking out of a water hose, or enjoy your time before school starts, or kiss your freedom goodbye. And I mean, that was extremely nerve-wracking to hear. And to add to this feeling, I'm sure most of you were apprehensive about moving across the state or country, adjusting to a new town, and getting settled in before school started. All this to say, my nerves were settled after the first couple days of meeting our class. At first, I was intimidated because I had never met so many intelligent, accomplished, and driven people in such a short period of time. However, I think we can all agree how incredibly close our class became so quickly. Learning each of our individual stories made me feel so grateful to be in this program with you all. The intimidation turned into admiration and gratitude for just the opportunity to get to know you. Throughout the whole year, we truly possessed a we can do this group mentality, from study guides posted in the drive, to encouraging words in the group me, to leaning on each other in stressful time. We truly emulated a team-based approach to PA school. And I think that's truly something unique that not every program or even every class experiences. So it's something I truly cherish most about our class. I challenge each of us to uphold the same environment and mindset on our rotations next year. Build relationships with other students and your preceptors, but also the office staff, the nurses, the MAs, and any other professionals that we come in contact with. In the thick of it, I would have thought I was crazy to say that I truly thank God for one of the most challenging years of my life. I reflect on how much we have grown, learned, and experienced together. And though it was seldomly rainbows and butterflies, there was something valuable to take away from every challenge that we conquered this year. For example, whether it was changes in our schedule with a tagline of be flexible, or being reminded that it's all about perspective while feeling like we were literally drowning in lectures, exams, and TVL prep, we came out on the other side with more grit, and we've really learned how to cope together during the stressful times. At the end of the day, I'm so proud of our class and all that we have accomplished. And while I was practicing my speech, I read that line and I was thinking, that does not emulate or take into account all that we've accomplished this year. So I did some digging, and we started school on July 12th, 2021, and we were actively in school for 45 weeks this past year. In that time, we have completed 4 OSCEs, we have written 13 papers, we have completed 39 projects, assignments, and TBLs, and we have taken, drumroll please, 43 exams in 45 weeks. So I think that kind of sums it up a little better. So think back to how you were feeling just 1 year ago and imagine how we will feel this time next year. We will be wrapping up our last rotation, we will be applying for real jobs, and we will be studying for the real pants. I mean, it feels so far away now, but I'd argue that this last year flew by, and somehow at the same time, it feels like we've been in PA school for like 5 or 10 years. So also, I'd like to give a quick shout out to all of our family and friends that are here today. I think I can speak for everyone in the room when I say that we appreciate all the good luck, texts and calls, the support, and all the encouragement along the way. We really could not have made it through this year without y'all. And to wrap up, I challenge you to cultivate meaningful relationships during clinicals, be humble with the patients that you meet, and always remember your why for becoming a physician assistant. I'm excited for us to conquer clinicals and show our preceptors what the class of 2023 is all about.
You know, sometimes you hear these acronyms, and I'll clear a couple of those up. You'll hear we have some neat acronyms. One, the students are about to start on what we call them clinical rotations, but the technical term is SCPEs. This stands for Supervised Clinical Practice Experiences. You heard Ms. Simon talk about the pants. That's not something you wear. It's the PA National Certifying Exam. I mean, the MD program may be pretty cool, but we have the best acronyms. So I'd like to welcome the next speaker. You know, our next speaker is a senior physician assistant at the Methodist DeBakey Heart and Vascular Center and program director for the Assistant CV Surgery Residency Program in Houston, Texas. He also holds the rank of adjunct assistant professor in the UTMB Department of PA Studies. He's a longstanding preceptor of the program. If you talk to the class of 2022, hands down, they'll tell you this is the guy that needs to be here talking to you today. He graduated from the UTMB PA program in 1990. He's been employed in cardiovascular surgery since graduation. Please welcome Mr. Bradovich.
Well, good afternoon, class of 2023. I know I'll be seeing some of you later this year. It's an honor to be here with you and your loved ones today. I'd like to thank Dr. Philpott, Dr. Beach, and the rest of the distinguished faculty, along with Shirley McGraw, for inviting me to this important event. As Dr. Philpott said, I graduated in 1990 from this very school, and after doing a quick research on the school's website, the only faculty left from the time I graduated is Bertha Mendieta, who was in Victoria. And of course, Shirley. So maybe some of you will be rotating with Bertha later on this year. I'd also like to congratulate you for completing this important milestone. I know COVID didn't make it easy. And maybe you were not as affected as much as the 2020 or the 2021 class, but you still worked really hard to get to this point, the countless hours studying, the sacrificed time with your family and significant others. You successfully completed this year, and as a reward here, you are celebrating this important event. Last but not least, as every other person that has spoken before me said, congratulate the families and the significant others that are here today, because I truly believe that without their support, some of you would not be here. So a round of applause to the families. So what does a white coat represent? What does it mean? Well, it's a tradition that began in the late 1800s. When trained surgeons and later physicians began wearing the coat, the white coat, as a way to distinguish themselves from phony healthcare providers, offering miracle cures and did not practice traditional evidence-based medicine as we do today. Today is a symbol of integrity, the highest commitment to caring for the sick and suffering, and professionalism. So what is professionalism, you think? Well, one definition that I like by Dr. Ali Lofty, who actually wrote a piece in a U.S. News & World Report back in 2021, describes it as three dominant frameworks: adopting values, displaying behaviors that reflect those values, and integrating those values into one's identity. So what are some of those values, you wonder? Well, some may say maybe being competent is one. Morality is another, showing respect, demonstrating responsibility, displaying good communication skills, and showing compassion. All of us at some point in our lives have been a patient, the recipient of care being rendered by a healthcare provider. And I'm sure we all expected that provider to be honest and make decisions in our best interest. That, you can say, is an example of a provider with good morals. Every day in our office, we see patients, or we get calls from patients about wanting questions answered or questions about their surgery coming up. And that brings up the point of responsibility. It is our responsibility to reach out to these patients in a timely manner. It is easy to say, I will call that patient later or tomorrow, but try putting yourself in the position of that patient and disregard the call. It's not a good idea. Another example of is showing up on time. Well, I grew up in Colombia, South America, so even though my name is not Pablo Escobar, that's where I grew up, and it is customary to arrive late for literally any event, whether it's a party, a wedding. And so the invitations always had to read 1 to 2 hours prior to when you wanted them to arrive. All I'm saying is try to arrive on time on your rotations, maybe 10 minutes early instead of 10 minutes late. So that's one thing. As it relates to respect, remember that in this era of social media, we need to be careful what we say about patients, what we post on Facebook or Instagram. We had a little incident in our hospital a few years ago. A nurse took a picture in the operating room and of a patient. It didn't even have the patient's name, but she ended up getting fired over that incident. So just be careful what you post. So what about this white coat ceremony? Well, it's a tradition that started, from what I did my research on, in 1993 at Columbia University, and from what I understand here at UTMB in 96. Since I'm a 1990 graduate, I didn't get the opportunity to enjoy this event like you guys are today. But it really means basically welcoming the medical students, when it started, to the profession, to hold them to the same code of ethics and responsibility, and to remember to keep the patient's best interest at heart. Since then, this tradition has been adopted by our profession, the nursing profession, pharmacy profession, to name a few. I remember the first time I wore my white coat. As I started my rotations, I was excited and proud, but I was also scared. I had doubts about my ability to take our history and examine patients, not to mention presenting patients to our preceptors. It was intimidating. It is okay to be scared, but I can assure you that this faculty at UTMB has done everything possible to prepare you for your upcoming rotations. Rotations where you will be challenged. Questions will be asked by your preceptors, and there will be times where you will not know the answer, and that's okay. Preceptors would rather see a PA student be honest and say, I don't know, I will look it up, rather than to make up an answer or worse, lie about something you did not ask during the history taking or something you didn't perform during the physical exam. Just recently, one of our PA residents was training with us, just started 3 weeks ago, was presenting a patient with tricuspid regurgitation. And the presentation was going great. I was very proud of her. And then the surgeon asked, does the patient have a pulsatile liver? She was taken aback. Well, I'm not sure what a pulsatile liver is, sir. And I don't think I did that during the physical exam. So he was happy to see that she was honest about not doing something rather than to make up a story. So just keep that in mind as you go through the rotations. They can see through all the lie and all the whatever stories you want to make up. So just be honest. I still feel that a solid history and physical is important to arrive at a diagnosis. Despite of all the technological advancements and diagnostic studies we have available today, it will certainly guide you to the correct test and not waste money on unnecessary studies. Some of these studies can be very expensive and may carry a significant copay by those patients, so keep that in mind. In my specialty, it can be very intimidating, not just because you're having to work alongside cardiac surgeons who can be short-fused, but because some of these patients are really sick and the majority require life-saving procedures. So being cautious is very important. Experienced PAs like myself, I guess, we have a lot of autonomy, and sometimes we have to make critical decisions regarding patient care. I think that as you grow professionally and as you gain experience, regardless of the specialty you end up choosing, you will, in due time, be asked to make critical decisions about your patients. But after 30 plus years as a PA, I remain very cautious with everything I do. The surgeon I work for, Dr. Lowry, always says the difference between excellence and mediocrity, it's attention to detail. So keep that in mind as you start this journey as a PA. PAs in surgery and other specialties can be trained to do procedures such as central line insertions, chest tube insertions, or even perform parts of a procedure like harvesting a vein for bypass surgery or harvesting the internal mammary if some of us are able to do that as PAs in CV surgery. But you have to remember your limitations as a PA. In our profession, that's called the scope of practice. And although there's some variation from state to state as what the law is, says, the majority have left it basically to be decided at the practice level. And so the doctor-PA relationship is important, but you also have to know your limitations. I can't stress that enough. You can go from being a hero to being a zero, literally in a second. Put in a central line, you can, you know, puncture a lung or put it in the artery instead of the vein. So it's very, very important to know what your limitations are, especially early on in your career. If you don't feel comfortable doing something or performing a procedure, don't hesitate to ask for assistance. Remember, first do no harm. Now, having said that and scaring you to death, I will tell you that it is an exciting time to be a PA. Just last year, we were number one in the U.S. News and World Report in the best job rankings for both the 100 best job list and the best healthcare jobs list. Well, how did we achieve that? Well, the rankings factor in important aspects of a job. One is growth potential, work-life balance, and salaries. The expected growth for our profession over the next 10 years is 31%, and it's actually a little higher here in Texas, 37%. So I think there's huge potential for us, and that's why these classes have grown from when I graduated. I think Gordon said that his class was 17, ours was 33 or 34. I think we started at 35, but I think we lost two along the way. And you guys are 90. So, you know, there is a definite need for PAs and all across all fields of medicine. On the work-life balance, our profession provides a path for PAs to have a family and still enjoy a career in medicine. And last on that list was salary. The median salary for PAs was in 2020 was $115,000. And as some of you may know, in surgery, it's a little bit higher than that as well. One thing is for certain. Our profession is here to stay, and after 55 years of existence, we have earned a place alongside physicians and other healthcare providers. This COVID pandemic certainly demonstrated how important PAs are in healthcare, and the American Association of PAs will continue to lobby and ensure that PAs in every state can provide patient care consistent with our education, training, and experience. This is actually the words of our president, of the chair of the board, which I agree wholeheartedly, especially since we have to compete for medicine jobs with other mid-level practitioners. I can honestly tell you that I'm proud to be a PA. I have had a very challenging and fulfilling career, and not once have I regretted becoming a PA. I'm so proud of this school, UTMB, your school, that I became a preceptor not long after graduation. I wanted to give back to the school that gave me the opportunity to become a PA. And while this is way too early for you to be thinking about, I would like to plant that seed today. Become a preceptor once you feel comfortable in your job. It has become increasingly difficult for programs to find preceptors, especially since we have more than 260 programs around the country. When I attended school, there were 60, so you see how much the programs have grown due to the need. So at least I encourage you to entertain the idea. I know right now it's way too early. The last thing I'd like to share with you is that as future providers, which before you know, you'll be one of us, you need to cherish and protect the privilege of being a healthcare provider. Patients will place their trust in you and believe that you will do everything possible in your power to assist them in what ails them. That patient-provider relationship is a sacred one. As I mentioned earlier, remember that while practicing medicine brings responsibility, it also comes with rewards. I remember like it was yesterday, this is about 15 years ago, saw a 79-year-old female patient who was diagnosed with pretty aggressive renal cell cancer that in some patients can extend into the renal vein and even in the inferior vena cava, as was the case for this lady. She was turned down for surgery by another surgeon, and we were called as a second opinion at the insistence of the husband. It was on a Friday afternoon. I went to see the lady, and when I got there, the case manager was already working on hospice care. I walked in the patient's room, and the husband quickly came to me and said, "Oh, thank you for being here. I really appreciate it." So I reviewed everything, talked to my surgeon. He reviewed all the records and said, "I think we can operate on this lady." And so we canceled the discharge to hospice, and we took her to surgery the following Monday. Well, she did really well, and we were able to remove the entire tumor, including the tumor extended into the vena cava. And about 10 days later, she was 79, so it took a little while to recover. But, you know, the day of discharge, the husband comes to me, gives me a hug, he's in tears. And for the first time, I'll be very honest, I could not hold back my own tears, tears of happiness for being able to provide the care that otherwise this lady would have gone to hospice and to die. And we actually heard from the husband for a couple of years after her discharge and doing well. So even if she didn't live much more than 2 years, at least we gave that husband and the young and her his wife a couple of years extra. So don't forget that to have compassion. That's the last thing on that list about professionalism. Sometimes that's something that we can forget as we get busy seeing patient after patient. So again, thank you for having me. I wish you the best during your rotations. And then remember that as you leave here to celebrate this weekend, you now represent not only yourself, but also your school and our profession. So make us proud. Thank you.
Hopefully this thing's working okay. So, as we've already heard,
The white coat carries with it a special privilege. It's a symbol of honor, integrity, respect, and responsibility. In my early career as a primary care PA, after I'd gotten my feet wet and a little experience under my feet, I volunteered to be a preceptor. And like any good preceptor, I had lots of pearls to impart to my students. These were useful nuggets of practical knowledge, horror stories, horn-tooting victories, and some advice from someone who also once wore a short white coat. And so I would carry around and often share this advice as tradition goes. And today I offer my pocket full of advice. When I watch TV shows, watch the medical shows on TV, I notice that the white coats are always clean and pressed and spotless. It represents your status, a symbol of achievement, the uniform of one in pursuit of a noble profession. In real life, what you'll see is stuffed pockets, slightly worn in appearance, and an occasional stain. They're a utilitarian symbol of a busy provider. So what exactly is in those stuffed pockets? Well, they're tools of the trade, handy items, doodads, and gadgets that hearken to the spirit of the Boy or Girl Scouts motto, always prepared. The pockets aren't quite big enough for a textbook or a laptop, maybe an iPad. But there are a few things that no white coat is complete without. So as you venture out into the clinical non-TV world, keep your white coat clean, wear it proudly, and fill your pockets with the following items. A reflex hammer. It's good for tapping tendons that reflex, and good for testing, and good for tapping your temple when contemplating those issues that perplex. Also good for testing hot and cold and squashing unruly bugs. In a pinch, it can be used as a weapon as you walk to your car, leery of thugs. Measuring tape. Used for measuring pregnant uteri, swollen legs, lesions, lacerations, and that surgical scar. Use it to measure accurately so you can document like a star. It's also good for tracking your own abdominal expansion since starting PA school. A handy device nonetheless. By the way, always document in centimeters. Anything else is just not cool. A pocket mirror. Sometimes used to check your dew after those long study nights. Also handy to check for spinach in your teeth before you flash your pearly whites. Can be used to show a patient an otherwise invisible lesion in the place they rarely see. Kids love them, especially after you fix their ouchie. Tell them how scars make them look super cool. They'll have a good story tomorrow for their friends at school about how this nice PA wearing a white cape was a superhero. And now, because the superhero PA helped them to lower their fear to almost zero. Scissors. A must-have for cutting off clothing during trauma. Needed to remove dressings and bandages without too much trauma. Handy for opening snacks and quelling those inevitable hunger pangs. And in a pinch for fixing your unruly bangs. Tape when you need it. So keep a roll or two in your pocket. It's a good idea for ACE wrap, splints, and maybe to cover a blister on your foot. Bandages, IVs, NG tubes, and other things that need to stay put. A tongue blade. Used for looking in mouse. A tool hard to find when you need it. Very useful indeed. Wow, I got the gag reflex before I even touched the tongue. I'm so good at this. Yes, very useful. Color one end to check peripheral vision. You can draw a face on one end to amuse little ones in a crunch, or you can use it as a utensil to eat your lunch. a charging cable. You just can't beat a charging cable. Recharge your devices when you're able. Tissues for that runny nose you picked up on the peds rotation. For wiping tears after losing a patient or delivering bad news or after you witness a miracle of birth. For the tears that come at lunch when your preceptor asks you a question to which you don't know the answer and you feel like the worst PA on earth. A pen light for looking in places where the sun doesn't shine. Careful, the batteries last 2.5 minutes, at least in mine. For checking pupils and transilluminating masses in throats and other places. A breath neutralizer. If all your patients seem to have a nose crinkled grimace and backward lean, consider PA halitosis and take action to make your breath dragon a little less mean. Keep some handy, spray, gum, mint, or candy. Use after coffee, snacks, or meals to keep your breath smelling dandy. Writing instruments. I like this one. It's a Carnival cruise pen. It reminds me of going on a cruise. Yes, your young, agile brain can absorb a lot, but not every detail. Your favorite pen will run out of ink at the most inconvenient time. Never fail. Better to have several of these, as they can and will disappear. Keep a few in your pocket, but not behind your ear. A notepad for jotting down labs, topics for later lookup and taking history notes, for writing down grocery items and those really good quotes, for keeping track of patients to log, and your growing to-do list when your brain is pure fog. Start each week by writing down a new quote to lift your attitude. End each week with reflection and gratitude. A mask. Nowadays, you should always have a mask. We've all been through it, don't ask. The stethoscope. Nowadays, the stethoscope, its usefulness never ceases. The most important part fits between the earpieces. Sometimes it's worn around the neck. It gets dirty as heck. Makes you look smart when you listen to bellies, lungs, and the heart. Bruise, murmurs, and bowel sounds can't hide. It's a badge of honor for students and practitioners. It's always worn with pride. Peripheral brain, my old friend. Your quick and dirty lookup for all the details that make me shine. You have a way of waking up tired neurons in this old walnut of mine. Can't possibly have all the answers on your pages, but you keep me sharp and brave as my old thinker ages. Oh, how I love this pocket brain. Without you, my clinical day would be insane. Moolah, handy for bribing your favorite nurse to do your bidding. Good for hitting the vending machine when carrying a wallet or purse is less fitting. Gloves, always a good idea to carry more than one pair. The further away from the box you are, the more likely you are to need a pair. And as soon as you don them, your face will fall in your hair. Your hair will fall in your face. As the old adage goes, as soon as you dirty them, you will need to scratch your nose. Yeah. Have some fun. Make a glove chicken. Don't get caught without them, or with grief you'll be stricken. A picture. Maybe your sweetie, or your dog Petey. Maybe your mom or dad, or the best friend you ever had. Maybe your savior or your spiritual guide. Steal a glance and bring a smile that you just can't hide. There is, of course, more you could put in your pockets. These are just a few. But don't leave home without these other things that make a special person out of you. Courage to go boldly where few dare to venture. Becoming a PA is a journey. and the scenery along the way changes rapidly. Fight temptation to be intimidated by this and face the challenge head on. Endurance to work through the long hours and grueling shifts in pursuit of knowledge and experience. Take care of your physical, emotional, and spiritual self first so that you have the strength and fortitude for the road ahead. Your patients look to you to be just a little stronger than they are. Humility, to know that you'll never know it all, and nobody expects you to. You have the unique privilege of being present and involved in people's lives at their most vulnerable times. Respect and treasure this special honor, and never take it for granted. Kindness, to treat others like family, assuming you like your family. Remember, people may not remember or understand what you say, but they'll understand and remember how you made them feel. People simply like you better when you smile. Amazement in knowing that you are studying God's greatest creation. Never lose the curiosity that led you to study medicine or your sense of wonder. Joy and love for your fellow human being and for your chosen profession. Patients know immediately when your heart isn't in it. Lastly, a sense of humor, in context and when appropriate. Medicine is serious business, but sometimes laughter is the best medicine. Make it a point to laugh every day. Not nervous giggling, not fake laughing followed by eye rolling, but laughter in response to something that genuinely brings you joy. You have a lot to smile about, so allow yourself to have fun and enjoy life and its many blessings. So class of 2023, I hope you heed my advice. Fill your pockets with hope and all your tools. Don't forget to be nice. Don your white coat with a smile. Put your name on all the items in your pocket and embrace the style. Well, my attempt at rhyming advice is done. Wear your white coat with pride. Go have some fun. Right now. Right now, just like all of you, just like all of us, you're floating on a cloud. Go forth, learn, and make us proud. Next in our program comes the cloaking ceremony.
I would like to welcome Professor Marciano to introduce her students.
And good afternoon, everyone. I'm Professor Veronica Marciano, and it is with great pleasure that I would like to introduce to you my faculty coach learning team. Priscilla Abraham from Dallas, Texas. Justin Holu from Meadville, Texas. Madeline McDaniel from San Antonio, Texas. Ashley Schwab Simon from Galveston, Texas. Christina Soyson from Houston, Texas. And
and Cheyenne Talent from San Antonio, Texas.
Good afternoon, I'm Professor Holly Good, and it's my honor to be here today to introduce my faculty coach learning team to you. Annalise Aris from Dallas, Texas. Viviana Chapa from Mission, Texas. Nina Josue from Quezon City, Philippines. Sterling Love from Houston, Texas. Tabitha McKinney from Cisco, Texas. And Cameron Squires from Katy, Texas.
Good afternoon. I am Professor Fadike Okilola. And it is my pleasure to introduce to you my faculty coach learning team, Safa Ali from Houston, Texas. Monica Lash from Lago Vista, Texas. Macy McFarland from Frisco, Texas. Shell from San Antonio, Texas. Aubrey Lauda Pearson from Kaysville, Utah. Emma Catherine Week from Hallettsville, Texas.
Don't worry, we'll get it.
Good afternoon, I'm Dr. Guillory, and it is my honor to introduce to you the best faculty coach learning team in the program. Tala Abushami from Lake City, Texas. Megan Brady from Dallas, Texas. Emily Herman from Mansfield, Texas. Justin Kim from Cibolo, Texas. Tolu Lomo Legbinro from Richmond, Texas. And Catherine Varner from Bel Air, Texas.
Good afternoon. I am Professor Dora Hawkinson, and it is my great pleasure to introduce to you my faculty coach learning team. Samantha Burton from Sugar Land, Texas. Rodrigo Castillo from Kingwood, Texas. Shirley Fong Wu from Katy, Texas. Megan Lockhart from Allen, Texas. Casey McLeod from Castle Rock, Colorado. And Francisca Yazigi from Sugar Land, Texas.
I am Professor Carla Hirsch, and it is my pleasure to introduce introduce my faculty coach team. Karina Mary Michelle April Bruzen from Cypress, Texas. Allison Graham from Spring, Texas. Wesley Green from San Angelo, Texas. Carolyn Gregg from Huntsville, Texas. Caroline Smith from McKinney, Texas.
Hello. Good afternoon. My name is Angela Jones, and it is my pleasure to introduce my faculty coach learning team. Abigail Hankins from Arlington, Texas. Chloe Hunger from Kingwood, Texas. She missed her calling. Kathleen Liu from Pearland, Texas. Jolie Scott from Cleburne, Texas. And Kelly Summers from Magnolia, Texas. Good afternoon. I am Dr. Julie Kutak, and I could not be more proud to introduce you to my faculty coach learning team. Brent Fluker from Kingwood, Texas. Heather Lowe from Dallas, Texas. I love you. Sarah Mahamre from Dallas, Texas. Mary Catherine Pace from Seabrook, Texas. Julia Smith from Katy, Texas. And Cecilia Tran from Spring, Texas. Good afternoon. I am Professor Darcy Ortiz, and it's my pleasure to introduce my faculty coach learning team, Paige Ely, League City, Texas. Yes! Jessica Garcia, Sugarland, Texas. Brittany Parks, Leonard, Texas. Raheem Sidwani, Euless, Texas. And not present today is Jessica Chen, Sugarland, Texas.
Hi there, I'm Professor Joe Perrin-Lawler, and it is my pleasure to present to my faculty coach learning team some amazing young ladies that I am just very proud of. Kylie Bieri, Magnolia, Texas. Told him not to do it, it'll make me cry. Kirsten Fishback, Katy, Texas.
Sorry.
Jenna Gray, College Station, Texas. Hallie Holden, San Antonio, yeah! Texas. Yeah! Alina Rogerio, Laredo, Texas. Angela Subedi, Fort Worth, Texas.
much, and I love you.
Good afternoon. I am Dr. Roker. It's my pleasure to introduce my first faculty coach learning team. First up is Alexia DeMarcus, Houston, Texas. Ella Grace Heinz, Seabrook, Texas. Kim Hong Picado, Punta Arenas, Costa Rica. Jessica Mattesino, that's Carmel, New York. Narissa Sorhato, Austin, Texas. Last but not least, Ariana Thomas, San Antonio, Texas.
Good afternoon. My name is Paul Shreve, and I want to start by setting the record straight. I have the greatest faculty coach team. So, all right. First is Catherine Campbell from The Woodlands, Texas. Joyce A. Garrison from Trenton, Texas. Austin Hull from Wichita, Kansas. Cynthia Nguyen, Carrollton, Texas. Carly Presser from Allen, Texas. Giovanna Serini from Butte, Montana.
Who's in Texas?
Good afternoon, y'all. Thanks for coming. I have the most wonderful
faculty coach group. I'm Dr. Michael Whitehead, and extraordinarily well-trained, I might say, too. Ana Diane Cardenas from San Antonio, Texas. Allison Engler from Coppell, Texas. Thanks, Mom. Savannah Stevens from Smyrna, Tennessee. Nancy Tran from Garland, Texas. And Gonzales, Texas.
One of our former faculty, Gary Perez, he was our associate program director. I think I made this job look fun, so he decided he wanted to do it. And he is now the program director at a program in Oklahoma, introducing his team as well as my team. The best team, of course. First is Christina Arif from Colleyville, Texas. From Arlington, Texas, Caitlin. It's a rolling brownout. From Plano, Texas, Hannah Chen. Lupita Cruz, Rosenberg, Texas. From Austin, Texas, Victoria Edwards. Maliha Falaha from San Antonio, Texas. Alex Hines from Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. Reagan Monteverde, Houston, Texas. From Houston, Texas, Holly Gruss. And from Lufkin, Texas, Jessica Sang. Ladies and gentlemen, the class of 2023. I'd now like to ask Fadeke Okalola and Carla Hirsch to come to the podium for the professional oath.
Students, please stand up, and faculty too. And if there are any physician assistants in the room, please stand. As I read, I want as you recite the physician assistant professional oath as I read. I pledge to perform the following duties with honesty and dedication. I pledge to perform the following duties with honesty and dedication. I will hold as my primary responsibility the health. Safety. Welfare, and dignity of all human beings. I will uphold the tenets of patient autonomy. Beneficence, non-maleficence, and justice. I will recognize and promote the value of diversity. I will treat equally all persons who seek my care. I will hold in confidence the information shared. In the course of practicing medicine. I will assess my personal capabilities and limitations. Striving always to improve my medical practice.
I will actively seek to expand my knowledge and skills. Keeping abreast of advances in medicine. I will work with other members of the healthcare team. To provide compassionate and effective care of patients. I will use my knowledge and experience. To contribute to an improved community. I will respect my professional relationship with the physician. I will share and expand knowledge within the profession. These duties are pledged with sincerity upon my honor. Thank you. You may have a seat.
Class of 2023, I think I speak for everyone in the room when I say we're extremely proud of you. And we look. And we look forward to watching you grow in the next year, and we look forward to hearing some really great stories from you. I want to congratulate you again and wish you well in your clinical year. I'd like also like to recognize and thank the parents, spouses, family members, and friends whose support is so important to our students. The Texas Academy of Physician Assistants sends their congratulations. They provided each of you with a TAPA pin to wear on the lapel of your white coat. Thank you again for attending today's ceremony. It's Friday. We're in Galveston. Have a great weekend.